Assalamu alaikum. How are you? Today we will start another unit of O-level physics 5054, that is unit number 3, dynamics. Already you have studied unit number 2, kinematics. Both dynamics and kinematics are the branches of mechanics, and mechanics is the branch of physics. In mechanics, we study the motion of the bodies. So what is difference between kinematics and dynamics? There is one basic difference between kinematics and dynamics. In kinematics, we study the motions of the body without reference of forces. But in dynamics, we also study the motions of the body but with reference of forces. So this is the basic difference between kinematics and dynamics. So let's proceed to our first learning outcome of the unit number 3, that is dynamics. And the first learning outcome is the statement of Newton's third law of motion. There are two statements of Newton's third law of motion. Number one, for every action there is equal but opposite reaction. For every action there is equal but opposite reaction. Or statement number two, or it can be written as well like this: action and reaction are equal in magnitude but opposite in direction. So in either ways we can write the statement of Newton's third law of motion. For every action there is equal but opposite reaction, or action and reaction are equal in magnitude but opposite in direction. In order to understand the concept of Newton's third law of motion, we will consider a simple example of a tennis ball. Right now tennis ball is in my hand. Now just look and observe what is going to be happen. What I am doing, I am just hitting the ball with the earth and ball bounces back. So in order to understand the concept of Newton's third law of motion, now we will look at this example. As soon as I am going to release the ball, it is moving towards the earth. As soon as it touches the earth, it applies the force on the earth which is called as action. So definitely it will be its weight. So it was exerting the force in downward direction, vertically downward. And when it hits with the earth, earth applies an equal but opposite force on the ball in upward direction. So this is the reason when I am going to release the ball, hits with the earth, it bounces back. So the force exerted by the ball on the earth is called as action, and the force exerted by the earth on the ball is called as reaction. So these two forces are equal in magnitude but opposite in direction. Why these two forces are not going to be cancel each other if they are equal in magnitude but opposite in direction? Because Newton's third law of motion is applied or applicable on two different bodies. We will assume the ball as body A and the earth as body B. So this is the reason these two forces are not going to be cancel each other. So I'm going to draw the diagram over here as well. This is the earth, and obviously I will consider it as a body B. This is the ball, I am going to consider it as a body A. So when this ball hits the earth, what will happen? It will exert a force on earth in downward direction, which is in downward direction, which is its weight. As a result, earth will also exert a force on the ball in upward direction, which is called as reaction. So weight was the force being exerted by the ball on the earth, was its action, while the force which was applied by the earth on the ball in upward direction was reaction. Another example from daily life regarding the Newton's third law of motion is that if I am going to hang some weights with the thread, definitely the weight of the bodies is acting in downward direction. This will be called as action, and as a result there will be an opposite force acting on the string in upward direction, that is called as tension. So the value of weight being applied in downward direction is action, and the value of force exerted on the string in upward direction is tension, is called as reaction. So these two forces are also equal in magnitude but opposite in direction. So its weight is being acting in downward direction is called as action, and the force acting on the string in upward direction, that is tension, is called as reaction. So this is called as action, and this force, this upward force, is called as reaction. Another example from daily life, that if we are going to place the book on the surface of the table, then again two forces are acting on the book. Number one, its weight is acting in downward direction. Obviously it is being acting on the surface of the table, that is called as action, and as a result table will exert an upward force on the book, vertically upward, exactly opposite to the weight, that is called as reaction. So that force which is acting in upward direction is called as reactionary force. So weight of the book acting on the table is called as action, and the force being exerted by the table on the book in upward direction is called as reaction. Another example from daily life is that, have you ever observed that when birds are going to fly, then how they are going to fly? They are moving their wings like this. So what is going to be happening? They are exerting the force on the air by their wings in downward direction. As a result, air exerts the force on their wings in upward direction, so they are being lifted upward. So birds fly like this. The force exerted by the wings on the air in downward direction is actionary force. As a result, the force exerted by the air on the wings in upward direction is reactionary force. Another example from daily life is that when we walk on the earth, so we pushes the earth in backward direction, that is called as action, and as a reaction earth pushes us in the forward direction, that is reaction. And another example from daily life, in order to understand the Newton's third law of motion, that when we are boating in a river by using a boat, what we are going to do? We are pushing the water with the oars in backward direction. So that is called as actionary force. As a result, water exerts a force in forward direction and our boat moves. So I hope that now you will be able to understand the concept of actionary and reactionary force, and which topic was this? Newton's third law of motion. What was its statement? For every action there is equal but opposite reaction, or action and reaction are equal in magnitude but opposite in direction. So let's proceed towards next learning outcome. Now we will start the next learning outcome of this unit, and that is describe the effect of balanced and unbalanced forces on a body. Now we will see that how balanced and unbalanced forces act on a body. So the first thing that we will discuss, that what are balanced forces. Okay ji, for balanced forces, what does it mean? Let's suppose if there is a body, two forces are acting on this body, 20 newton on right side and 20 newton on left side. So how many forces are acting on this body? Two. 20 newton on left side, 20 newton on right side. So what will be the net force or total force? That will be definitely 20 minus 20 is equals to zero. It means the forces are balanced, or it can be considered as well. Let's suppose if there is a string and the weight of 40 newton is acting on it in downward direction, then definitely tension acting on the string in upward direction will be also equals to 40 newton. Now, are these forces are balanced? Yes, these forces are also balanced forces. So in balanced forces, net force will be always equals to zero. For balanced forces, there are two possibilities. Number one, the body might be in the state of equilibrium or rest. The body might be in the state of equilibrium or rest. And number two, there is another possibility that body is moving with uniform velocity or terminal velocity. These are the two possibilities when forces are balanced. So when forces are balanced, what will happen? Body will be in the state of rest or in equilibrium, or body will move with uniform velocity or with terminal velocity. And in this case, we have already studied in previous unit that when body moves with uniform velocity or terminal velocity, acceleration will be always equals to zero. If body is at rest, let's suppose mass of the body was 10 kg, body was at rest, definitely acceleration will be equals to zero. Then what will be the value of force? Value of force will be equals to 10 into 0, that is no force was acting on the body and body was in the state of rest. So what should we keep in our mind for the balanced forces? That net force will be equals to 0, due to which body will be in the state of rest or in equilibrium, or body will move with uniform velocity or with terminal velocity. And in that case, if body is moving with terminal velocity, acceleration will be equals to zero.
अभी तो मैं जवान हूँ, अभी तो मैं जवान हूँ.
ओके, कैमरा एक्शन लाइट कट. So the concept of balance forces is now clear to all of you. Now we will proceed towards another concept of unbalanced forces. Let's suppose if I am going to consider the example of the block on which again two forces were acting, 40 Newton towards right side and 20 Newton towards left side. Now what do you think, that whether these forces are balanced forces as we have studied the previous topic? No, these forces cannot be balanced forces. What is the reason? Because forces are in opposite direction but not equal in magnitude. So if I am going to consider this force as F2 and this force as F1, so then definitely net force or total force will be equals to F2 minus F1, that is equals to 40 minus 20 is equals to 20 Newton. So net force, or we can also write it as resultant force as well. So net force or resultant force acting on the body is 20 Newton. And we will draw the net force or resultant force acting on the body towards which side? So larger force was acting on right side, so definitely body will move in right side direction. So we will draw the double arrow in order to show the resultant force acting on the body towards right side. What was happening in the case of balanced forces? If body was moving, then it was moving with terminal velocity and uniform velocity, and acceleration was zero because net force was zero. But in case of unbalanced forces, definitely acceleration will produced in the body in the direction of force. So in this case, acceleration will produce in bodies, acceleration will produce in body in direction of force, in direction of force, or you can say in the direction of net force or resultant force or total force. Another example of unbalanced forces is the example of a car. Let's suppose I am going to draw the diagram of a car. So this is the latest model. The car is moving on the surface of Earth. Let's suppose it is moving in this direction. So definitely capital F will be engine's force as car is moving towards right side. So two forces will act on the car in opposite direction of motion. Number one, F air, and number two, F airs mean air resistance. F airs mean air resistance. F means force of friction between tires and road. So now how many total forces are acting on the body? Three forces: engine's force, air resistance in opposite direction, as well as frictional force between the tire and the road in opposite direction as well. So two cases are here. If forces are balanced, for balanced forces, for balanced forces, what will happen? F is equals to F air plus F. In other words, body will move with uniform velocity or terminal velocity, and acceleration will be equals to zero. So for balanced forces, acceleration will be equals to zero because body is moving with terminal velocity. For unbalanced forces, what will happen? Definitely for unbalanced forces, capital F, engine thrust, will be greater than F air plus F. Now what will happen? Acceleration will produce or not? Yes. If forces are unbalanced, acceleration will produce. So therefore, acceleration will produce. So in this way, we have studied the difference between balanced and unbalanced forces. So I am just going to review it, that in balanced forces, no resultant force, no net force is acting on the body. The body will be in the state of rest or equilibrium. Or if body is moving, then body will move with terminal velocity or uniform velocity, and acceleration will be equals to zero. For unbalanced forces, there will be definitely a net force or resultant force or total force acting on the body, and acceleration will produce in the direction of force. The next learning outcome of this unit is very interesting, that we have to discuss the ways by which a force can change the motion of the body. What does it mean? That how we can change the motion of the bodies, and we have to discuss those ways or those methods. I will consider example from daily life, and that is the example of a car. In order to move the car, definitely first of all we have to switch on its engine, applying the gear. And now in order to move the car, what we will do, what will be our next step? We will definitely press the accelerator. As soon we are going to press the accelerator, car will start moving. Larger the pressing force being applied on the accelerator, larger will it attain the speed. In other words, its motion changes by applying the accelerator. So when accelerator is being pressed, what is happening? Acceleration is being produced in the car in the direction of force. Now if car is moving and we want to again change its motion, what we will do? Definitely we will apply the brakes. When we will apply the brakes, what will happen? Its speed increases or decreases? Definitely its speed decreases, because when we apply the brakes, frictional force is being applied in opposite direction. So again, its motion changes. So when we apply the brakes, what is being produced in the car? Deceleration. So there are two ways or the two methods by which we can change the motion of the body. Number one, by applying or by pressing the accelerator, and number two, by applying or by pressing the brake pedals. Now we will discuss next learning outcome of this unit. Now we are proceeding to our next learning outcome of this unit, and that is learning outcome C. Equation is written over here, F is equals to ma, and this belongs to Newton's second law of motion. So this equation gives us the relation between F stands for force, m stands for mass, and a stands for acceleration. So this relation gives us the force in terms of mass and acceleration. From here we can conclude that A is equals to F over M. This gives us two sorts of relations. Acceleration is proportional to force and acceleration is inversely proportional to mass. So what does it mean? That larger the value of the force, larger the value of the acceleration. Smaller the value of the force, smaller will be the acceleration. So it means when force increases, acceleration in the body also increases. When force decreases, acceleration in the body also decreases. But there is an inverse relation between acceleration and mass of the body. If mass of the body increases, obviously it will be a heavier body, then its acceleration decreases. And if lighter body is there, if mass decreases, then obviously acceleration increases. So this is called as Newton's second law of motion, F is equals to ma. We will solve one example. Let's suppose mass of the body is equals to 1500 kg. Body was, or you might say velocity of the body changes from 10 meters per second to 25 meters per second in 5 seconds. So we have to find the value of force. What was the formula of force if mass and acceleration are given? F is equals to ma. So I will write over here F is equals to ma. Value of mass is given, but where is the value of acceleration? So we will use the concept of acceleration from chapter number 2 or unit number 2, kinematics. That what was the definition of acceleration? Rate of change of velocity. So we will calculate the change in velocity per unit time. That is, mass is equals to 1500, and how we can calculate the value of acceleration? What was initial velocity? 10. What was final velocity? 25. In how much time? 5 seconds. So 25 minus 10 over 5. 25 minus 10, definitely it will be equals to 15 over 5. When we will solve this, 3 will be here. So 1500 into 3, that is equals to 4500. So how much force was exerting on the body of mass 1500 kg, whose velocity was supposed to be changed from 10 meter per second to 25 meter per second in 5 seconds, is 4500 newton. So Newton's second law of motion is clear to all of you. Now we will proceed to our next learning outcome. So the next learning outcome of this unit is, friction is a force which impedes motion and produces heating. Impedes mean prevents. Or you might say in simple words, opposes. Okay, so how we can prove that friction is a force? There is a very simple activity with which we can prove that friction is a force. Just start rubbing your both hands. Now you can feel that your hands are going to be warmer as you are going to rub your both hands with each other. So what is happening? Actually, when we are going to rub one hand with the other hand, friction is being produced, due to which heat is being produced. Friction plays a very vital role in our daily life. Number one, without friction, we cannot walk. If there will be no friction, it is not possible for us to walk. The example is very simple from daily life. That if there is a slippery road or there is a oil on the road, then we cannot walk. We will slip down. But opposite to it, friction stops us as well. If we are running, we have to stop ourselves, then it frictions in contact between our shoe and earth, which stops us. Again, if there will be no friction, then we will be slipped. We cannot stop ourselves. So friction produces heat and it prevents motion. How it prevents motion? Let's suppose if we are going to roll a ball on the surface of earth. Now, as soon we are going to push the ball or roll the ball on the surface of earth, it will cover some distance, and after covering some particular distance, it comes in the state of rest. Why it comes in the state of rest? It is due to friction. Friction always acts in the opposite direction of the motion. Let's suppose if body was moving in this direction, then friction will act in opposite direction. And in order to apply the friction in the bodies, the two bodies should be in contact with each other. The tire is in contact with the earth. So when two bodies are in motion and they are in contact with each other, then definitely friction will produce, and friction opposes the motion. Okay, another example from daily life is that whenever we are using the tires of the car, what happens? After a particular time, due to the friction or due to the frictional force, the tires wear out. They are going to be flatter. If there will be no friction, there will be no grip, and we will be not able to stop the car. If there will be no friction, we will not be able to move the car or start the car from its initial point to its final point. So friction has advantages as well as disadvantages. Now we will discuss another learning outcome of this unit, and that learning outcome is also related to frictional forces.